Hello, LaSalle. We're the Campbell family, coming to you from our home in Wilmette. I'm Chris.
I'm Ami.
I'm Helen.
I'm Lydia, and this is Sebastian. Welcome to worship this morning with LaSalle Street Church, a place where you can come as you are, stay where you are, and grow into the person God is calling you to be.
Thank you for your presence today. We hope this morning you feel Jesus' presence and the peace of Christ as we worship together.
Please join us in prayer. Gracious God, you are the Alpha and the Omega. When we greet the day, we greet you and your marvelous creation. We encounter once again your expansive, excessive, and encompassing love. Thank you for bringing us together to praise your name and hear your word. May we open our hearts for the Holy Spirit to enter and do its mighty work. And may you remove any doubt in our minds that it will be so. It's in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we pray. And all God's people say,
Amen. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Gracious and merciful God, we've gathered all throughout the world right now because we believe that despite the global context that we are in right now, this still is the day that you have made. And we shall rejoice, God, and we shall be glad in it today. God, meet us where we are today. The mother that is watching, the father that is trying to decide what to do next, the son and the daughter that finds themselves in the valley of decision. Help us now, Lord God. Help us to understand the hope that we have in your word. Your word that says that we can cast the whole of our care even over unto you because you care for us. We thank you, Lord God, that it's at the entrance of your word that we find that hope. Your word, God, that reminds us that your love never fails. Your grace is always sufficient, and your power is made perfect even in our every weakness. For this is a time where we have opportunity to express and to show weakness. But this is also a time where we can trust in the Lord with all of our heart and lean not unto our own understanding, and in all of our ways acknowledge you, and you will indeed direct our paths. Direct us this morning, Lord God, as we lay everything bare before you. Direct us this morning, Lord God, and lead us to that place that only you can comfort us in. For your word says that you are our refuge and our strength, a very present help in all times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. For you've not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a spirit of sound mind. So we decrease now, that you might increase in us, that we might hear your word clearly this morning and have everything that we need to get through yet another week. God, we lift our senior pastor to you right now. We pray that you wrap your arms tightly around her, that out of her heart today will flow rivers of living water, that she would give life to the hearer, Lord God, and that that hearer would become a doer of your word. We lift this entire service to you right now, that you would get all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. Now unto you who is able to keep all of us from falling, Now unto you who is able to make all grace in every earthly favor and blessing abound towards us. Now unto you who is able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that we can ask or think, be glory, dominion, and power. For we don't ask these prayers in our name, but we ask them in the name of our King who has come. For Christ is risen, and Christ is risen indeed. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen. Good morning. If you are worshiping with us on the LaSalleStreetChurch.org/live website, I'd invite you, click on the video, and then click on the video title. It will take you to our YouTube page where you can join in with the online chat, or you can search for us, for LaSalle Street Church on YouTube, for our channel as well. But if you're able, I invite you, join in to that chat, sign in, let us know that you're worshiping with us, and say hello to the other LaSallers who are singing this morning. Let's begin our service by worshiping together.
Lord, I find you in the seeking. Lord, I find you in the doubt. And to know you is to love you, and to know so little else I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Lord, I find you in the seeking. Lord, I find you in the doubt. And to know you is to love you, and to know so little else I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Lord, I find you in the morning. Lord, I seek you every day. Let my life be for your glory, woven in your threads of grace. I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Oh, how I need you. Light, glorious light, I will go where you shine. Break the dawn, crack the skies, make the way bright before me. In your light, I will find all I need. All I need is you. Yeah, light, glorious light, I will go where you shine. Break the dawn, crack the skies, make the way bright before me. In your light, I will find all I need. All I need is you. Oh, how I need 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 you.
As we continue in worship, join us as we meditate on these verses from Psalm 16 and from the hymn, Be Still My Soul. Pastor Randall will lead us in reading parts of the psalm together, and you'll see those words come up on your screen. And I will lead us in the verses we're singing. So let's continue together.
Keep me safe, my God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, you are my Lord. Apart from you, I have no good thing.
Be still, my soul, the Lord is on your side. Bear patiently the cross of grief or pain. Leave to your God to order and provide. In every change, He faithful will remain. Be still, my soul, your best, your heavenly friend. Through thorny ways leads to a joyful end.
Lord, you are my portion and my cup. You make my lot secure. The boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Surely I have delighted in inheritance. I will praise the Lord who counsels me. Even at night, my heart instructs me.
Be still, my soul, your God will undertake to guide the future as in ages past. Your hope, your confidence, let nothing shake. All thou mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still, my soul, the waves and wind still know His voice who ruled them while He dwelt below.
I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With Him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest secure. You show me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. And at your right hand, there are pleasures forevermore.
Be still, my soul, the hour is hastening on, when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joy is restored. Be still, my soul, when change and tears are past, all safe and blessed we shall.
People of God, Jesus said in his word, "Peace I give you, my peace I leave with you." Let us take a moment now to take out our cell phones and text a sign of Christ's peace to those that we love.
But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord, my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe."
I was raised in Babylon. A priest taught us how to worship the sun. Oh, where did we go wrong? They used to call us civilized, those days are gone. I came to guide the Pharaoh, bring him wine and women. Whoa, where is he now? We used to call him the highest till a wave took him down. I was born in the Holy Land. They told me it was by God's command. Whoa, where are the others from? I thought that we were the chosen. I must have been wrong. I love to march with the Sultan and his diamond turban. Whoa, then the world took hold. let go of the rope of God for a handful of gold. I used to serve the empire. I wish the sun set never. Oh, and now the times have turned. We thought our white skins would save us, then we got burned.
Good morning, LaSalle. Hello there. It's Laura Truax. I'm coming to you from my home. We have a home office here, and I am been here for 8 weeks, just like you guys have been there for 8 weeks. Surrounded by all these books that I really have been wanting to read, and people, surrounded by people, not a lot of people, just a couple of people. Two of our sons and daughter-in-law are with us and quarantining with us, so very nice to see you. I know things are getting a little weird now, aren't they? We've been spending a lot of time alone. Week 8 of our remote isolation, and I don't know about you, but it's beginning to show on us. Today we're trying some different things. We recognize that what we really miss is each other. The pleasure of chit-chat and random hugs. And so we're trying to figure out ways of bringing that Sunday engagement into this live stream. So you had different people welcoming us to church today and another blessing us as we depart, along with some video clips and different ways of engaging throughout this sermon. So give us some feedback. Give us your thoughts on this. We're eager to know. We're all wondering, of course, when this is going to be over. And this stress and this worry is starting, I think, to weigh on us a little bit. Our questions, our suspicions are kind of highlighted. Last week, Lucas told us that we're taking part in this larger facility. It's a study being done by Salesforce on the impact of our ministry. And so far, only a fraction of us have actually done the survey yet. Although everybody has an opportunity, okay? Every Wednesday in the Wednesday e-news, there is a link to click. But I just want to bring this up and highlight a couple of information about us, little tidbits on us. One, you can see that as of today, we've had 84 people respond, and 65% of us say that we are stressed. On a rating of 1 to 10, we are saying we're at least 7 or above. That's significant, isn't it? 26% of us are feeling lonely, and 27%, almost a little bit more than a quarter of us, believe that our jobs are at risk. So this is a very real thing. These are not the statistics of strangers, right? This is us, a slice of us. We would love to have that be more robust, so please, on Wednesdays, just jump online to the COVID-19 survey there and get your data in there. We'll be able to track this over time. On Wednesday of this week, Julie hosted a call with some college students from LaSalle. Not all of them could be on the call, but a number of them. And we were sitting around the Zoom call asking them about how life had changed. And I mean, think about it. A college student, you're on the cusp. You're stretching your wings, soaring right into the unknown. So we asked them a couple of questions, or she did. And one of them was, what do you fear? And one said, you know, I have the fear of being locked up all day, every day. It feels like there is this endless loop that will never come to an end. I thought that was real. A few of them on the call had talked about how when you move into college, the big life task is to learn how to orient yourself, how to actually get stuff done, right? Without anybody telling you to get stuff done. That's the big hurdle from that high school to college window. And so one of the young men said, you know, I've done it pretty well. I've got a schedule. I check off the boxes of what I want to achieve. He said, now all that's taken from out from under me, and I'm at home, and I have to ask myself, is watching Netflix all day a good use of my time? And there was this long pause. Probably not. Probably not. Yeah, we're all learning new things, aren't we? Today, in John 20, verse 19, we're told that the disciples are locked in this room because of fear. How completely relevant, right? Locked in our own homes as we are. We're locked in because a pandemic is raging. For them, they are locked and afraid because of religious leaders, we're told. But I also kind of wonder if maybe they're frightened about seeing the man who has risen from the dead, the return of Jesus. We're told that Thomas hadn't been with the others who had gotten a glimpse of the risen Lord. The stories of Jesus' sightings, as we heard last week, had been nonsense to many of them. And we're also pointedly told that Thomas had been isolated from the group. And there's a part of me that wonders, what does that do to a person? Because Thomas is very specific here in this passage about what it would take for him to believe, what it would take for him to feel certain that Jesus is in fact risen from the dead. It's almost like he's started to mull things over, as if maybe he put up his own defense system. What would it take for me to believe? Well, I don't know. It would take more than just seeing him. I tell you what, I won't believe until I literally have touched his hands and put my fingers into his wounds. And for that comment, Thomas gets the moniker Doubting Thomas. Doubting Thomas? Sounds like reasonable Thomas to me, right? Honest Thomas. Thomas knows that there is no particular virtue in gullibility, that there's no particular virtue in saying, I believe, when in fact you don't believe. No, Thomas to me is a man who refuses to say, I understand, when I don't understand. He refuses to pretend to believe when he didn't. He's a guy who has enough integrity to be authentic about his doubts. Well, what about us? Are we at that same place of honesty? With ourselves, with God, with one another? Behind our own locked doors, are there still places that we're hiding? Are there still things that we're hiding, either from Jesus or from others? Are you professing religious answers you know you don't really believe? Maybe because you think that's the right answer that people are looking for? You know, we asked the college students how they were making sense of this time. Listen to the honesty, unguarded honesty captured in these responses. And by the way, I, of course, reached out to get approval, but just listen to how Josh Blim, at a particular window of time, gives voice to what he's thinking and feeling, and Helen Campbell and what she is thinking and feeling. Let's listen.
I would be lying if I was to say that I'm fearing a lot. I'm kind of blessed that I've got a family that's loving and supportive, and I'm in an area that is supplied with food. I currently don't have too many fears. I think us as a nation, we're gonna get over this. I think we have the right systems in place to kind of get out of this situation that we're in. And I know I'm coming from a place of privilege that I have that comfortability with me. So it's hard to say I have too many fears or doubts currently.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I think for me, it's been less of a question of whether or not God loves me and more of a question of what on earth is God's plan in all of this. And I don't like it. And like, why is it something that I don't like? Because, I mean, the past 2 years for me have been just really rough. And I think I talk with my mom about this. Like, we just don't, we have a hard time seeing where God is in all that and where his plan is. Because the scriptures, you know, promise that his plan is good. And I don't see how what's happened has been good. And so it's kind of a challenge for me to remember that it's okay to put it in God's hands and okay to trust that somehow he's going to make something good out of all of this.
You see, it all belongs. It all belongs. The rousing recognition of blessing that Josh knew so acutely right then, and the stark honesty of, I don't even like this plan. But do we believe it all belongs? You, me. In verse 26, it's powerful to me that Thomas has stayed engaged in this whole process. He hasn't checked out. We're told specifically he is still with the group. You know what it's like when you're rolled by doubt, don't you? I mean, the book of James gives that great description that the person who doubts is like being adrift at sea with the waves crashing over them. We don't like that feeling of doubt. We don't like that feeling of uncertainty, of conflicting information, of challenging experiences. In fact, we'll do everything to try to keep those things at arm's distance. We are hardwired for congruity. There's a psychological reward in congruity. And it's so great that we'll think, I am not going to deal with that. I will refuse to consider that. I will not let this even in the door. I'm tuning it out completely, and I will not ask what it means. But that's not good enough for Thomas. He doesn't want a faith that's half-baked, or that's only filled with the good stuff. You know, in one of the Zoom calls on the Happy Holy Half Hour, we were talking about this text a little bit, and what does it mean, actually, to stay in the room when there's ambiguity and challenge and change and maybe even conflict? We thought about how hard it is to stay in a relationship when you're hurt or feel sidelined or left out or let down. I would love to see a show of hands of how many households have had at least one person storm out of the dinner table or out of the room from a heated conversation in these past few weeks. Please, it's got to be more than us. Or how many other households maybe have stayed in the room in person but have totally fled emotionally? You know, my husband and I have joked over the many years that we have really one repeating argument. For the past 30 plus years of married life, there's really one thing that we keep orbiting around, or one framework, one way of behaving that we keep orbiting around in a conflictual way. That used to be a joke. But now that we're with each other 24/7, there's no real joking about it. We're realizing if we want to have a relationship that can flourish in the midst of these kind of conditions, then we've got to talk seriously about stuff. Stuff that we've been avoiding. Stuff that we've put on the back burner. We cannot pretend to play nice. We have to be honest. We have to get to the bottom of some stuff. And we have to integrate that truth going forward. Thomas needed a faith that was going to be big enough for his life. And don't we need that too? Don't we need that in our relationships, in our families? A framework that's big enough to include it all. I mentioned this a few months ago, the poet Christian Wyman. I'm on a kind of a Christian Wyman jag right now. But when he returned to the Lutheran faith of his upbringing, he didn't return to the faith of him as a 12-year-old confirmand, just out of confirmation class. He returned to his faith as a 50-plus-year-old man. a man who had been diagnosed with incurable cancer, a man who had had failed relationships, who had been fired from jobs, who had felt the pain of years of going unpublished. He needed something that was going to bring all that in, because he's learned at 50 plus years of age that you can pray day and night for a cure and it may never, ever come. And you can storm the halls of heaven for a better job, a job where you're more fulfilled, more respected, and years later you can still find yourself in this kind of dead-end profession you started with. You needed a faith that could include that. We can't have these lives that we want, these religious convictions or marriage or a life, a flourishing life, where it's always up and to the right, like on the graphs. But one thing we do have to do, we have to stay engaged. We have to stay honest. We have to say authentic. You have to be in the room, in the conversation. We have to have these habits that we just keep doing. One of our youth, Jonathan Swain, a student at the School of the Art Institute, came to that exact expression of phrase earlier this week. Let me just show you what he had to say.
I guess the biggest takeaway I've had with faith is that regardless of any, if it's various manifestations, it's a product of habit, no matter what. And it's not necessarily something you can do where it's once you're in times of, I guess, struggle or in times of hardship, it's not necessarily that you can just address it then and then not worry about it regardless whenever else. It's a product of consistent habit, no matter if you are in a strong connection or not. So
this is what Jonathan is committed to doing. Here's what Jesus is committed to doing. He's committed to keep showing up. It was never about Thomas's faith or his lack of it. It wasn't about what he believed or his doubts. Thomas just had to be in the room. He had to get past his hurts, his ego, and whatever else that might have kept him outside. The what ifs, the why nots, why them and not me, the feelings of being sidelined. He had to move past that. He had to be in the room. But that was all he had to do. Just be honest in the room. Jesus was going to take care of everything else. Let's look at the text, verse 27. It's on the eighth day. And that phrase, the eighth day, let me just say it again if you've not heard me say this before. Those baptismal fonts of the early centuries all the way through the Middle Ages, they were formed generally with eight sides on them. The eighth day was God's time. And people believed that when you were baptized, you entered into a new framework of time. So on the eighth day, I love that little detail here in John 20, on the eighth day, when the fullness of time was at hand, when the time is right, Jesus appears in this liminal state, right? Where the old is going away and the new is not yet revealed. He comes not when there's certainty, but when there's faith seeking understanding. As one of the great saints of the church, Saint Anselm, said, faith seeking understanding. He comes into the locked room with his attention fixed on Thomas, and he offers Thomas the opportunity to get exactly, almost word for word, what Thomas thought he wanted. Go ahead, buddy. Touch my hands, feel my wounds, see my side. And in that moment, Thomas realizes he didn't actually need any of that. He didn't need the proof of Jesus' wounds. He didn't need to touch the scars. Jesus had him at his gaze. And under the look of Jesus, Thomas stops looking at himself and what he perceives he needs and fixes his look, his gaze, right back on Jesus. Brothers and sisters, this morning, let's do what Thomas did, what Helen did, what Josh did, what Jonathan did. Jesus stands right here now in the closed rooms of wherever you find yourself, inviting us to look at him, to fix our attention on him in the same way he fixed his attention on Thomas. He's asking us, bring me your doubts. Bring me your fears. Bring me your whispered hopes. Bring me the rejected parts. Bring me the faith that you wish was better. Bring me the understanding that you wish was clearer. Bring me those experiences you can't explain, those emotions you want to refute. Don't run from them. Don't try to hide them. Just let me fix my attention on you, and you fix your attention on me. This morning, in this gift of technology, we have the amazing Rob and Bethany Clearfield coming to us from their home in Paris, France, and singing a song that some of you have heard them sing here before, American Tune. And I invite you, while they're singing that song, that if it feels right, if you feel comfortable with this and willing to do this, how about putting in that live stream chat right there on the YouTube channel? How about sharing something that's on your heart? Something that is keeping you up, something that you are perplexed by, confused by, saddened by, something that is weighing you down that you would like to just put out there. Maybe it's doubts, maybe it's uncertainties or anger or sadness. But allow us, if it feels right, allow us to hold that with you. Allow us to be with you in the room the way the disciples were with Thomas in the room, all together with Jesus showing up in our midst. And if that doesn't feel comfortable, no problem. Maybe join us sometime this week on a 4 o'clock Zoom call. Lucas will give you the details on that. It's on our website. Join us for that. Join us in the morning or this week, this coming week, we have an evening reflection. So join us on a Tuesday night and let us just be church with one another. Because sisters and brothers, we're all in this room together. Jesus included. May the peace of Jesus be yours. Amen.
Many's the time I've been mistaken, and many times confused. Yes, and I've often felt forsaken, and certainly misused. Dream that's not been we've lived so well, so long. Still, when I think of the road we're traveling on, I wonder what's gone wrong. Can't help it, I wonder what's gone wrong. I dreamed I was dying. I dreamed that my soul rose unexpectedly, and looking back down at me, smiled reassuringly. And I dreamed I was flying. And I dreamed I was flying. Oh, we come on the ship they call the Mayflower. We come on the ship that sails the moon. We come in the ages most uncertain hour and sing an American tune. Get some rest. That's all I'm trying, to get some rest.
Hey, hey, LaSalle. This is Lucas. I am your communications director. I'm coming to you from in front of my Mad Max-style apocalypse survival vehicle, and I have a couple short announcements that I would like to share with you all before the conclusion of our service this morning. If you are a guest with us, if you have never worshipped at LaSalle before, either in person or on our stream, thank you so much for tuning in this morning. We have a digital Connect card that I would love for you to fill out. You can get to it by going to our live page at LaSalleStreetChurch.org/live and clicking on the button that says Digital Connect Card. This is a great first step in order to get plugged into some of the things we have going on here at LaSalle. Share your contact information so that we can stay connected with you in the coming weeks. Looking forward at today, right at the conclusion of our service at 11:15 a.m., the study group looking at the book Me and White Supremacy will be meeting via Zoom. If you are a part of that group, you should have already received an email from me with the Zoom meeting link and password that you'll need to access the discussion. But if you don't have that for any reason, shoot me an email as soon as you can, and I will send those login credentials to you before the meeting begins again this morning at 11:15 a.m. Looking ahead at this week, you should know there are multiple Zoom chats that go on every weekday at LaSalle to give more opportunities for LaSallers to connect and stay sharing with each other during this time of isolation. Whether or not you have joined those meetings in the past, everyone should know that the links for those Zoom chats have been updated as of this coming Monday. We've had to move them to a new Zoom account. So if you've joined the Holy Happy Half Hour call before, the morning meditation, you're going to need to update those bookmarks in your web browser. You can find all those links on our live page as well as our community hub. Of particular note, this week we have the evening reflection coming up this Tuesday, May 5th at 7 p.m. This group has been on pause for a little while, but we are bringing it back in a slightly longer format that will meet every other week. If you're interested in that, sign up. You can find that again on our live page. Finally, as Pastor Laura mentioned in the sermon, we are beginning to receive the results for our Social Suite survey. This is going to provide some really, really interesting data. So if you have not had a chance to fill out that survey yet, I would encourage you definitely today, click on that link on the live page, go fill out the survey. It's going to provide us some really robust information to help understand where the needs of the LaSalle community are being felt most prevalently right now and how we as a church family can best respond. That's all the announcements I have for this morning. I have a busy afternoon ahead of me. I need to figure out what kind of unfiltered diesel this guy takes. But until I can get that figured out, thank you so much for joining us in worship, and I will see you again next week.
And now, as we depart from this space that we have created, but not from the presence of God, may we remember that God is not threatened by our doubts, but wrestles with us on this journey. May the deep peace of Christ that passes all understanding be with you. May the wide love of God that empowers us to serve others stay with you. And may the strength and power of the Holy Spirit guard and protect you as you go. Amen.